Level One Scrubs podcast. I am Sean Bernard. I've got a massive couch tonight. Steve is going to be out. He's actually going to be in the chat moderating for you guys tonight, but I'm going to actually just go down the line. Everyone introduce yourselves. I think we all know each other.
I hope so.
You can go.
Oh, that was
why did you look at me like, is it my turn?
Because you kept talking.
I'm always talking. Just
go. Direction.
I am Kate. I'm also known as Phantom Joe on AYB.
I guess we only have the one microphone.
You have to pass the mic.
I am Jamie, also known as Jay Tanuki.
And I'm Dan, also known as Dandroid.
Okay, yeah, you guys. So it's a full Scrubs podcast tonight. We're bringing some awesome things to you guys on top of the news. We're actually going to be talking about some picks for Game of... Jesus Christ. some picks for Game of the Years. I think we have our individual picks. They're in the notes. I really should have read them before we started because I never do. But we're just going to dive straight into it, talking about the CSGO Elite X tournament that we hosted actually on Saturday. For those of you who are tuning in for the podcast and watch us on Saturday, you guys know what I'm talking about. For those of you who don't, I'm going to let one of you guys explain it because I did a lot for it already. So I want to hear one of your guys' perspective on it. And what it was and what happened. And
Dan should do this one.
Come on, Dan.
Why should I do this one?
Were you even here?
Yeah.
I was in a booth the entire time.
How can you ask me to talk about this when you're not even sure if I was here or not?
I sat up in the booth above us for fucking 10 hours.
All right, well, I'm going to lay it on you. You did an excellent job. That's what you did. All right.
Thank you. I showcased 10 hours of CSGO. My voice hurt.
This man is a fucking machine. Like, he just went and went and went. Like,
well, the trick is... don't know what you're talking about the entire time. And it's really easy.
I call that method just throwing shit against the wall until it sticks.
Well, a gentleman by the name of Magni, who's also a Counter-Strike player for here in Winnipeg, helped me co-host. And the funny part was he was like asking me, he was like, do you have any tips, advice? I was like, I don't know what I'm doing. So that's my advice.
You heard it here first.
I'm not even kidding. Like our producer, Josh, myself, Magni, Dave, and a couple others were here the night before setting up. And Josh kind of looked at me and was like, so, what are we doing? I was like, what do you mean, what are we doing? I'm just a caster. do we know?
You know you're screwed when your director looks at you and says, so, what are we doing?
The official start time of the tournament was at 2 p.m. on Saturday, last Saturday, sorry. And I'm not even kidding. We didn't have the video output figured out until 1:15 p.m. that day. It was kind of like, so we found out that Windows can't mirror the same display for three times. So yeah. We needed to send a feed internally here at Reset. You could come down and watch it. I'm kind of taking some of your light here, Dan.
No,
and
no,
then we were sending it to Twitch. The people here watching on Twitch.
I don't know what I'm doing.
And
either,
then there was my display. Who, like, I was the one driving. So anyone who was watching, you saw what I was seeing and trying to cast at the same
time. Was that the triple monitor setup?
So it was the triple monitor setup. But Windows will not mirror three displays. It's either mirror one, extend two, blah 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 blah. So we're like, oh, fuck. We should have tested this the night before.
Yep.
But so I'm not even kidding. We sent Josh, our producer, at 1 o'clock. An hour before we're supposed to start, technically, to Best Buy across the street to buy an HDMI splitter so that we could technically have three monitors but tell Windows we're only using two. And then it's like, Twitch authentication went down, so we got everything working, and it was like, by the way, you can't log in. So it's like, well, what was the fucking point? The capture card refresh rate wasn't working, so it was like we had to figure that out like last
minute. You were like losing your goddamn mind, like
someone
running
came
here
up
before.
And they're like, are you ready? I was like, no. I don't want to be here anymore. I'm done. But I'll let you take thank you. It was tons of fun to cast, actually. I enjoy it. But I'll let you guys take it back off what exactly happened.
Yeah, basically we got here a bit early because we came to see if we could help with setup or anything like that, and more or less, it was just kind of problems everywhere, and I'm like, well, I don't know what I'm fucking doing, so I hope it all turns out. But no, it was an awesome event. It was great to hear on casting again, because even though you don't know what you're doing, you sound like you know what you're doing, and in the end,
that's
isn't that
the
all
trick.
That
if you sound really enthusiastic, it just sounds like you know what you're doing. So, but no, thank you. It was. I have to say the weirdest thing is because there's a booth, and you guys on at Twitch right now can't see it, but it's actually you can. There's kind of this roof here behind me, and that actually has a booth right above it, and that's kind of where the DJ houses himself sometimes and all that stuff. They put us in there. Now, I'm not even kidding. There was, like, room for the casters and our producer. That was it. Anyone who came up, we're told them to get the fuck out.
Yep.
Our server who was helping was, like... she would just come up and put stuff on the edge of the stairs and be like, I swear, am I supposed to put
this? It's like
this?
Being in a bear den.
It was I think 28 degrees the entire time.
Oh,
and Magni, who's like of darker skin, for lack of a better term, right now, looks at me and goes, "It must be a white thing because I'm happy." I was like, "Yeah, I guess so." But you would come down. So like, I started, and there was like, we started off. It was just the players and a few people, and I came down around 2 p.m. or like 5 p.m. from after like 3 hours of straight casting. Take a couple minute break, and this place was packed.
Yep.
I went back upstairs, came back at 8, and there was like people showing up for the bar because it technically was a Saturday night. And then I came down like 10 o'clock, and there was just like this big group of girls. And I was like, "You don't belong here right now." I was like, I'm thinking to myself, these people have to listen to me, and they're probably like, "Why aren't we dancing?"
They were all playing beer pong anyways.
Yeah, that was a really funny thing because we had our new webcam set up because we finally bought our own instead of YouTube bringing your own. We had it sitting here. I don't know if you guys could see it, but you could actually watch people playing beer pong.
Yep.
And people were like, "I want to go play beer pong at a bar." Get down here. So.
It was a good feed because it showed off what was happening. You could see the computers in the background. You could see people walking around. You could see people playing beer pong. We were playing X-Wing miniatures down on one of the tables there. Like,
we'll have to talk about that because that seemed really cool.
It was actually kind of cool, though, because when you would be walking around on the floor, there's a whole bunch of couches set up behind us, too. But it looked like people were just, like, there watching the TVs right at this bar over here. It just looked like they were at a movie theater. And everyone's just, like, watching the play-by-plays. And they're just like, "Oh!" when something happened that was awesome and stuff.
I had to unfollow our Facebook page. And for any of those who are watching, you should go like it right now at AYBOnline. But because our producer Josh, as well as some of the content team, people were firing up articles and posts like really, really quickly. So I get notifications every time we were like casting, like, "Hey, where are you?" I'm like, "I know I'm doing this right now. Can you stop doing this?" Like, so it was really, really good. So shout out to the content team who was massively on top of all the results, and Steve for getting his insane. I don't know if this has been released yet, but his insane interview reel that's coming out soon, if not out already. But I want to know from, in terms of, like, your guys' perspective, because you three are not big Counter-Strike fans. Or not fans, but players.
I used to play, but it was long before probably even you were playing, so.
Leave 1.5 out of this. 1.5 alpha, probably. Is in terms of, like, what the experience was like as a person who doesn't play or watches, like, the mainstream kind of Counter-Strike tournaments, because, like, there's ESL, these are these big ones. To be sitting in a venue and watching these things happen, like, what was the experience overall for you guys? Yeah, I don't know. You guys can start however you want.
I'll start.
Yeah, go ahead.
I'll just go.
So I don't really know anything about CSGO, at least in terms of the technicalities of it. Like, when they talk about economy, don't give a shit, really. I'm sorry. I just don't understand that stuff. But I am more of a visual person, so if I see, like, a cool headshot, I'll be like, "Oh, man, that was sweet." But overall, the experience here was really, really cool. It was I was actually kind of surprised just how many people were
only hundreds of dollars in equipment. Shut up. Keep going.
It was really, really cool seeing how many people were here to just watch the event. And even if you weren't here to watch the event, it was really neat because the arcade was open. You could still order food. It was still a good time. I remember I was running around taking a lot of photos.
There was a lot of pictures being taken,
yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, so
a lot of Instagram, a lot of Facebooking going on.
So actually, some of the posts that were sent out onto our website, some of the photos that we took are in those posts and stuff. So it was one of those fine tunings to finding, like, a good picture without it being, like, super blurry or anything, because it's dark in here, so.
It's dark, but it's not unmanageable dark.
Yeah, like,
it's
exactly.
Yeah, but there's a lot of different colors, a lot of flashing lights going on and stuff, so it can screw up a lot of pictures.
It's a nice ambiance.
Yeah.
But yeah, that was really fun, just kind of running around. And we also were talking to just regular people who just came to show up, and we asked their feedback. It was overall pretty positive. It was really, really awesome just seeing how everyone took it.
Hmm. Jamie?
Thank
you with your earbuds going on.
Yeah, honestly, like Kate was saying, I don't really know a lot about CSGO, and I don't really follow a lot of, like, esports and that, but it was really cool being part of the ambiance and just sort of experiencing what the energy was like in here. That was really really interesting. And then also just seeing some of the teams that, like, even though they got knocked out pretty early on, mm-hmm. they still stuck around and just hung out with everybody. And, like,
this bar, I believe, at one point was just covered in people.
Yeah. Like, the bar was full.
I think that was...
Online, even if they weren't drinking, like, they were just sitting, watching, hanging out with mm-hmm. people, networking, like, probably making some new friends. And a lot of them, I'm sure, have never even been to Reset before. So to be able to expose them to that is really cool.
I think that was Keontae and his team that was lining that bar.
Yeah, shout out to Keontae and his, like, following of, like, insane people in the chat room. Seriously, I'll talk about those guys in a minute. Keep going.
Absolutely. And then, like, also running around and taking pictures of the venue and stuff, and just being here to experience some of that. Like, it would definitely get me interested in going to, like, a professional esports event, just to see, like, what it feels like being there, even if I don't necessarily know anything about the tournament that's going on.
Yeah, like, I love coming to events like this because I'm not a big sports fan. So this is my sporting event. Going to something like this, this is like kind of being at a Jets game for me. Kind of like it's the energy in the air, especially when half the teams are shouting that they just, you know, headshotted someone or something like that. It's absolutely amazing to be here. The energy and the just watching. I love to see it because it's. I used to play CS:GO like or Counter-Strike like a long time ago, but being able to see like. Newer teams playing, actually having announcing for it and stuff like that. I absolutely love watching it, so it's an awesome event.
It's okay, so one of my favorite memories from Saturday so far is, so I'm up in the pit. I've got headphones on, but like I can hear the background noise, and probably the weirdest thing ever is actually hearing yourself talk, which was really off-putting for me at first because I was critiquing what I was doing at first. But at one point, I was kind of like, I'm just saying the same thing over and over again. I was like, I'm bored. So I started like making fun of the players. I'm like actively making fun of the players. And like all I remember is I can't remember if I said something, but like everyone down here just started like laughing, and you could hear like people like yelling shots fired and just hysterical shit across the board. I was like, you know what? This is the rest of this cast. We are just going to make fun of people. One of the players actually spent the entire game running around with a shotgun, which in terms of like firepower is just really bad. And we're just like, okay, so no.
That's like when they pull the twin Berettas. It's go time.
It's just so fucking funny. These guys, like the Winnipeg Counter-Strike community and those who want to like compete, make sure you guys come down. Is probably the most insane group of people. Like they've been working together, playing together for so long, like not in teams, but like just as a community. A lot of the guys like know each other like in and out. So like they had a beer count going on each other's game names and stuff. So you can see like Keontae had like 6 on it, and like people were like really upset because the bass would be playing.
Yeah.
And we tried to turn it down as much as we could without like snuffing out the music and making it sound washed out. But like people would start putting in like Advil or like Tylenol on their names because they were just getting headaches from like the bass playing. But, like you can't like do everything right. So like whatever. But super awesome. But shout out to, oh God, I better get this right. I'm pretty sure it was Cyber Revolution who won. Yeah, Cyber Revolution who won 2-0 in the grand finals up against Almost Dead, who came second. And I don't have a number on number 3 because we did not fight for number 3. So shout outs to our third/fourth places. Joint Conspiracy, who is We Are Eagles, because they don't know how to make names. And Keontae's team, who was Eclipse 69 subs CYB sub Cyberplebs, because they just wanted to make my life a living hell the entire weekend. So getting into more esports talk, while we were gone, actually, one of the bigger leagues, and I'm pretty sure everyone has some kind of affiliation with these three letters, MLG, also known for 420 MLG, get wrecked, get trekked, you know, Doritos, COD kind of thing. You know, they're most known for doing Call of Duty. What is the other one?
Do they do League of Legends, or is that
no,
their own thing?
No, MLG is more Call of Duty and Battlefield. That's it. They're more known for doing that.
They also do Rocket League.
They're the only ones besides us to ever do a Rocket League tournament. Yeah, take that, internet, which I showcasted along or with Commander Santa. But they got bought out by Activision, who actually owns Blizzard, as well as, who else did they buy? They own a fuck ton of people.
Yeah.
For $46 million, roughly.
They own everything. Yeah, total value is $46 million, but it's like $30 million something.
It's like $30
million
in stocks.
Is actual price value.
Yeah.
And then the other, whatever, 10.
It's like 10, 10 16 million in stock.
Is
like,
like in
it's like a security fund so that if anything goes tits up with the acquisition of it or like transferring over, because they're also taking over all of the debt that LG currently holds, which is, I guess, a lot because they had to account for that in their extra, whatever it is, $13 million.
So my understanding of what happened is MLG is just not doing very well.
Apparently not.
No. Yeah.
They owe a fuck ton of money to a lot of different people. So Activision would said, so Activision has actually previously picked up, he was the head of an esports federation for a bit. Fuck, I can't remember his name, but he's a big name in the esports world. They picked him up as the head of their esports division, and people are like, you guys don't host esports. And now they've bought MLG.
They kind of
like,
do now.
Yeah, it's like, okay, so, which is cool, because they have their World of Warcraft every year. There's the World Years every, that's actually tons of fun if you don't. They do StarCraft, they do all this stuff. So, they already have a presence. They already have a presence in the esports world. Which is really, really neat. I'm going to turn this up because I'm actually slouching and my back is fucking killing me. But now they have MLG, and I don't know if they're going to keep the trademark. I'd like to see them keep the trademark.
I would too, just because they have, you know, even though MLG owed a lot of people a lot of money and stuff like
Well, they don't owe anyone money anymore.
Well, not anymore, but when they did.
They gave them money in trust, essentially.
Even though there's a lot of people angry at MLG, obviously, for owning the money, MLG still has that presence. MLG is, like, the name in esports and kind of those gaming events and stuff like that, so I really do hope that they keep it. I mean, they could change the logo, they could do whatever, but keep it as MLG. Just, you know, it works so well for memes and stuff like that.
I don't know.
And I know in the notes it said vision is to bring like it to television, but I think that was actually confirmed as well, wasn't it? I'm pretty sure it was.
So there's only ever been two, I believe, successful television broadcasts ever in the world of esports. The first one was on TSN2. Oh, both of them, I believe, were on TSN2. One of them was TI5, so previously the year. The finals were actually on. Mm-hmm. That was fucking hysterical. And the League of Legends World Finals, I believe, were also broadcast years ago on TSN2 as well. So one of the head directors, I think that's where it came from. That's one of the guys. So one of the guys from TSN or something came over to Activision. They bought him, pretty much. They probably said, we want you for this bunch. So they gave him a fuck ton of money.
Yeah.
And now they have MLG. So there's only been two successful broadcasts. So, and I believe the idea is not actually to broadcast on TSN2, but to actually have an MLG-dedicated channel. And I got to remember, there is actually going to be an esports channel. I believe it's MLG or someone else is starting it. But it's going to be like actual TV series. We're going to have things about, you know, players and their housings, like player homes. So
like player cribs, almost?
Not player cribs, but there's a line, there's already these famous things.
I believe that was TBS.
No, that's TBS is that's their own thing. They're having their own show Counter-Strike and everything like that.
Yeah, for that.
This was going to be a separate channel altogether.
This is a separate channel, and I can't remember who was announcing it, but it's like a separate like gaming esports channel dedicated, and it's going to be 24/7, like, you know, gaming. It'll be previous matches, that kind of stuff. Esports podcast analysts, because there's a lot of stuff like Day 9 and all of them do their podcasts. They do the weekly analysis and they do the patch analysis, which would have been really nice for Counter-Strike with the R8, because that was a big one. A bunch of shit. So I think everyone's looking and going, okay, this is now a feasible area. Let's start to do this.
Does that, okay, now I got a question for you. Does that actually get you excited? Because I know that you like your esports.
I don't have
like
fucking
that.
TV, so and no.
No, but I mean, they're obviously.
Who has cable these days?
It's Activision. They're with the times. They're not going to be broadcasting, or they're not. I don't think their main outlet is going to be TV. I think it's going to be an online channel that you pay a subscription for, just like a lot of other services.
Which is like a lot of these other services. I know, like, actual mainstream TVs cutting a lot of their packages and going online only.
Because everyone's leaving. Everyone's going online.
Everyone should make a Chromecast app just so that we can get away from that.
Yeah.
CBC and Global have one, and it's fan-fucking-tastic.
Exactly.
I mean the truth is that cable's just dying.
Yeah,
so.
Exactly.
Cable's a dead medium, man.
Yeah.
It is, yeah.
But anyways, does that get you excited? Like, do you want this channel that's dedicated? Do you think there's enough content to actually fill an entire channel? Like 24/7? I know that they're trying to make themselves out to be sports because sports have so many dedicated sports
it's
channels.
It's not just sports, but it's like the insight into like players' lives and behind the scenes and that kind of stuff.
Yeah, that's the thing is they're going to have to fill it out with stuff like that.
Yes and no, but that's because I'm a really shitty person to ask. I don't watch, like, even if I sit down and I watch Twitch or I watch Netflix or something, I'm never actually really focused on. It's more of a filler at this point. Like, unless I'm watching Making a Murderer on Netflix. For those of you who haven't watched it or haven't seen it yet, you should go watch it because that shit's fucking insane. But like Making a Murderer or fucking unless I'm dedicated to watching, like it's gripped me. 99% of the time, I'm not giving a fuck.
Oh, okay.
Like AGDQ, which is happening right now, we're gonna talk about it a little bit, but like I'll watch that because that shit's insane. So it I guess it's gonna be based on the content they put out. I don't know. I'm not too hyped about it. I'm like, okay, cool. That's really awesome in terms of what we do.
Yeah.
Because like shit like this could be on there eventually. Like it's really awesome to see like things like this getting big. But at the same time, I'm like, eh.
Yeah,
who the fuck has time to watch TV these days?
That's the thing, is it's. I think it needs to be more than just...
By the way, you guys should watch our podcast. Don't take that another way.
It needs to be more than just an MLG channel. I think it needs to have just like Nerdcast in general on it. They need to have other shows that kind of go outside that realm. Because if they literally just show, you know, Dota, LoL, Counter-Strike, and like Rocket League 24/7, it's going to be a little dry after a while.
I would love to see a Big Brother ripoff of... for like esports players.
I would watch that.
It would like be 15 guys in one house for 6 months and just like they can't leave or don't know what's going on outside of the esports world. And all they have is one game.
PlayStation kind of did something like that. It was called The Tester. But it was like a reality show where somebody got the job at the end of it, but they had all the challenges. They all lived in a house together and stuff like that. So I almost guarantee they will make something like that. Especially if someone wants them to join their like high-end team or something like that. They'll be like, all right, go live in a house with these other guys and prove you're the best.
A lot of them actually already videotape it, so I think they're just going to monetize it on it now.
There we go.
Kate, or someone else can take the next point, because this one I'm not super in for, because the remake for Final Fantasy VIII was shit.
Oh, okay. Well, I mean, there's been news about it on various
PC, GamerMag, Kotaku, which is a new source.
Final Fantasy IX is getting a PC port, finally.
Could you sound any less incited for this?
Apparently. Well, because I just found it today, so I've been trying to like look into some more about it. All I know is that from the two things that I've heard is that they've updated their character models.
Which can be worrisome.
Which we saw previously be the wrong thing to do.
I guess the one thing that kind of concerns me about that is because in the game, in like the original like release of the game, like the backgrounds are like super beautifully like rendered and everything like that. So I kind of wonder if they're going to update the backgrounds too, because fully nicely like updated models are going to look really weird against low res backgrounds.
Well, that's what happened with 8.
Yeah.
It's exactly what happened with 8.
So hopefully they take notes.
Because the problem is what they did was they took a PlayStation 1 game that had what would have been a really nice piece of art that was highly pixelated because it was crammed onto a PS1 disc.
Oh, yeah.
And then what they did for the remaster of it was they're just like, we'll just put the blur effect and kind of get rid of some of them pixels. And the problem is when you throw that on an HD widescreen, it looks like a muddy mess.
What do you mean my 4K monitor won't look good on that?
Yeah, I actually never checked out the PC version of FF8.
It's garbage. They've screwed it up twice now, as far as I know, because with the remake of 6, like which was Super Nintendo's 3, which is Final Fantasy 6, they redid all the graphics in that game for Android and for PC and stuff like that.
Just looks super unimpressed.
It looks like garbage. It looks like somebody went into like clip art. And yeah, it looks like a crappy Flash game. Like, I don't know what they took one of the best RPGs of all time and just completely ruined it.
And I'm a little bit nervous for FF9 because I really loved FF9 when I was playing when I was younger. And
I haven't played any of them, I don't know.
It's nice. But another thing I just found out too, but is that apparently they're going to include the option to turn off random encounters.
Now, could you please explain this? Did you read about it? Because I want to know what the hell they're thinking.
Did anybody, three of you read of it?
I can...
No one?
I'm...
No.
Which?
Did any three of you read about it?
I read a bit about it, and I read that they were going to allow you to shut off battles. And I'm just like,
wait,
what the fuck?
Because, and I have a bit of a bone to pick with that, because if anyone's played any Final Fantasy game, random encounters are just a staple. That's how you level up. That's how you get past certain points in the game. You level up by random encounters. And this option to turn it off is kind of a little bit... counteracting that is just kind of dumb in my opinion. I mean, I guess I can understand if like you're in an area, you're trying to just get to destination. It's like, damn it, there's so many like encounters here. But like that was kind of the fun in the original game, was that like you actually had to work hard to get to your destination. And well, like,
and I mean, usually by the time that you can just like wipe the map, like no problem walking through, you had an airship or some kind of way of traveling or something like that. So they were never in the way. I mean, like when you take something like a JRPG, you take out the random encounters, you're shutting off half the fucking game at that point. And it's just like, what are you playing then? How are you leveling up? Like,
it's
what
speed
is
running.
The point of playing? Yeah, but I mean, that's even that, it has its limits, though. I mean, the point of it is to speedrun a game is to speedrun the game, not just like, oh, let's just turn everything off in it. And
well, and here's the other thing, other side of the coin to that, too. Particularly with FF9, there are certain enemies, like what is it, that enemy that basically asks you true or false questions.
Yeah.
That is purely by random encounter, and you can get some sweet shit out of that. Like, so just turning that off
that
is
sounds
just
exciting. Answer this question. Am I asking you a question, true or false? No, you get this.
How can I tell
random
that you've
crystal
never,
that will help you.
How can I tell you don't play JRPGs?
Exactly.
we'll have a conversation in a minute.
Please do.
Keep going.
But yeah, like it's just things like that where if you turn off the random encounter, then you're kind of not getting the most out of it.
That'd be like playing Mario and turning off the Goombas. Like, I mean, there'd be no point.
What are your thoughts on this?
Jamie just sounds
unimpressed.
Oh, she's enraged by us.
Here.
And so I wouldn't say I'm enraged, but I definitely have a strong opinion about that.
I have strong opinions of things every week on this podcast. Tell me how you feel.
Like everybody else has already stated, I mean, like, the idea of a random encounter is part of the experience of an RPG or a JRPG. And it's part of leveling up. Now, if there's a game that you can play that, how am I trying to say this here? If there's a game that you can play that is quite linear and doesn't require the random encounters, like, what's a good one? Final Fantasy X probably doesn't necessarily need the random encounters because it's quite linear, it's well-paced, the leveling system in and of itself is well-paced. But I mean, I didn't play Final Fantasy IX, so I don't really know exactly how the pacing of the leveling system is in it, if it's actually more of a requirement to be able to do that regular grinding.
All right.
So, I mean, I guess it's dependent on what the actual gameplay is like and how they actually do leveling and, like, the algorithms involved with it.
Hmm. Interesting. It actually got me thinking for a second. Sorry.
Please explain.
Well, no, because I'm a programmer by trade, right? So it's like it's all programmatic on how you do it. So
It's like obviously there's an algorithm in place that you're going to get X number of experience, but it's like if the experience is minimal compared to what's regularly part of the game as part of the storyline, as part of the regular interactions that progress the storyline, grinding isn't necessarily all that important as far as a random encounter system. But again, it's dependent on what that game is and how effective random encounters really are in it.
So there will always be encounters. Like, so they'll probably, what they'll do is they mean by random encounter. So there's an algorithm that's constantly rocking the back. It's just like, you've moved this way this many times, like times this number, like the modulus of this number, does it equal 9 times 43 divided 7 to the square root of 4?
You're hurting my head.
Exactly, right?
Sometimes it's like a random.
It's just like a stupid
generator.
Equation that some high or drunk coder at some point was like, yeah, let's do that. And so they'll always be like, God damn it, they really turned up that sound, didn't they? But they'll always have encounters. So like you'll always, like, no matter what path, they'll be like, yeah, too fucking bad. The trigger's like the entire map, so you're going to have to hit it.
Yeah.
But like if you don't want to have to worry about the stuff. So they'll probably still give you the right amount of experience as you can progress through the game, normally making it a very linear example.
That's the thing. I want them to explain what they mean by shutting it off. Is it literally if you shut it off, the XP will be shifted to those other battles that you have to do? Or if you can just, like, literally shut it off, like you were saying, where it's like, oh, I want to go from point A to point B, and I don't want to be interrupted, so I'm just going to shut that off for now and walk there and then turn
it back
on.
There'll be some QA guy who makes sure that you can progress through the game without any kind of random encounters and have the proper amount of interaction and shit that's proper. And then that's about it. So
I know, it's hard to say.
Yeah, because, I mean, they'd have to basically go back and rebalance the whole game with, like, what XP was happening and stuff like that. But
it's
probably
like that.
Well see.
And I know that there are some certain points in the game, too, where, like, you do have to grind and level up because you have to, like, pass certain areas where there are significantly tougher enemies.
Well, yeah, of course. I mean, you have to be You have to defeat bosses. You have to level up. You have to get new equipment and stuff. You can't do any of that without XP.
I distinctly remember going through, like, one area where it's near the end of the first disc, and this area had, like, the toughest, just normal enemies. And I was like, what the hell have I gone? Like,
did you shut your random encounters off?
No, I didn't. I grinded like a normal JRPG player. So...
All right, yeah. So talking about games that are coming up to the PC here soon, one of these that I called, and I think we actually have it on tape or in one of the podcast episode, is Rise of the Tomb Raider is coming to PC with small hints that it's coming to PS4, and a lot of people are pissed because they don't read the fine fucking print. So Rise of the Tomb Raider did extremely well in the Xbox One. It's probably one of the better games on Xbox One in terms of, like, games that haven't broken, like Halo 5 and shit. But it's coming to PC here soon, which wasn't, like, everyone knew they were going to port it over.
Well, like, that was the thing, is that when they announced that at a game show, like a Gamescom or whatever, the problem is people buy into the word exclusive way too much, because as soon as that guy said, get it exclusively on Xbox One first, they didn't listen to that part. It's you got it on that system first, but it was still going to come to the other ones. You have to listen to it says exclusively on this system only. That's when it counts.
Yeah, so a lot of people are pissed, but you know, if they weren't upset about that, then they'll find something else to be angry on.
Of course.
I just bought all the Tomb Raiders except for this one on Humble Bundle for like $8.
Totally worth it.
So I don't know what it's about. Yeah, I don't know if it's still going on, but if it's still going on, go buy that game. You can get literally all the Tomb Raiders for like $9, or like when I got it. So that'd be cool. I don't know. I'm not a huge Tomb Raider fan, so we can move the fuck on if none of you guys know what the fuck we're talking about. You're all looking at me with your glazed over eyes.
I don't know. I'm excited. I really want to play. I tried the Xbox version when I was at PAX last year.
Oh, that's right. I forgot you guys go to PAX.
I had so much fun at that demo.
It's been a long time since we talked about that.
Actually, I think I remember on the episode too. I think I actually mentioned, I said, yeah, they're coming out with a PC version. So, I mean, it's just going to be an extra weight.
Okay. There we go.
So I'm honestly not surprised at the whole PC release or anything like that.
Yeah, I'm excited because, I mean, that's... I think we've kind of gone beyond that whole thing of needing to have like 50 different games exclusive on a system.
I'm calling it right now. The next game to be on PC will be Destiny.
Oh, yeah. I guarantee that it will be. Because
they're losing out on such a market.
That's the thing, is it's all about market share. And all these companies keep saying, like, oh, we got to make money. But then it's just like, you're going to lock your game to one system. That's the stupidest thing. It's not about exclusives anymore. It's about spreading it to every console and every system.
Exactly. So, I cool.
And I'm glad it is, too, because I don't have an Xbox One, and so I can eventually play that one. So.
Yeah, so Tomb Raider's a thing. Hooray!
Yay!
So, a game to actually be excited about. Wubba-lubba-lub-dub. fucking Adult Swim this week dropped some bomb news, and pretty much every fucking Adult Swim nerd fanboy out there, including myself, like, shit their pants. I think I didn't even read the article. I read the title and went immediately to the App Store. And I was like, what? So, you know what? Why don't you guys take this fucking thing? I'm doing all the work. Jamie, kick it off.
Oh, go ahead.
Oh, me? Okay. Is it because I made the typo on the notes?
Did you actually?
it's on there.
Well, it says Rock and Morty.
Yeah, Rock and Morty.
I don't know what that game is, but I'm excited for it.
She's excited for Rock and Morty.
Yeah.
Adult Swim came out with an announcement that they're coming out with a Rick and Morty game for Android and iOS. Now, they already have a Rick and Morty game out, but I believe it's just a Flash game only. But this is like
what
a brand...
Fuck?
Yeah.
Fuck Flash. Flash needs to die.
But this is going to be a free-to-play mobile game for Android and iOS coming out next week on
literally
the 18th.
A week.
And it's effectively Pokemon meets Rick and Morty.
Well, that's... Yeah.
And it's...
The best part about that was I was on Reddit and somebody posted a GIF of them walking around and they got into a battle and I was just like, holy crap, somebody spent a lot of time making this cute little GIF of this fake game. Later that night, you tell me that it's a real thing.
No,
I'm like,
it's real.
That was the screen share that they shared from Adult Swim.
Like, the guy posted it just as a GIF, and I was just like, oh, that's cool. That I wish that was a game. And then later on, my head exploded because it is a real game. So,
the reason they're calling it Pokemon for Rick and Morty is because it's called Pocket Morty's.
Yeah.
Obviously, fucking
and
Rick
is. And it looks like fucking Pokemon.
And it looks like you're going to be different characters because if you know Rick and Morty, there's the universe of.
It's the multiverse.
The multiverse of Morty's.
Multiverse Morty's. So, it's all the.
So, you'll be essentially collecting Mortys. I hope you can have like six different versions of Morty.
Oh my god, I want to catch them all.
Them, like Pokemon in the same format and everything. Like it looks almost identical.
I love those
standard,
guys.
Like,
it's
Pokemon
the little parallaxing screen. Yep. You all slide on, and you have your lasers and everything. It's perfect.
Yeah, you have the back view of yours and the front view there.
Those guys are doing great fucking things with that franchise or that fucking content. Because they're already in Dota 2.
Yep.
Yes, and the announcing system is hilarious. It gets a little repetitive at times, but my god.
It is the only reason I can play Dota 2. I honestly don't give a shit about the game. Like, it's a fun game to each their own. But, like, I'm like, okay, I'm losing. I don't know what to do. But, like, every once in a while, like, Rick and Morty will come on and be like, Morty will be panicking about something, and Rick will be like yelling at him and like a burp, and just like, I knew there was a reason I like this. I knew there was a reason I'm here.
Makes it all better.
It makes everything better. So, very, very excited for that. Tune in next week. Me and Steve won't be actually talking.
I'm sure you'll actually be talking about it because it comes out on the 14th.
Well, we won't be doing anything but sitting
around. So that'll be on Thursday.
It'll be an hour of you just
I really hope that you can trade your Mortys between other people.
You have to be able to. I really hope so.
So, yeah, Pocket Mortys comes out January 14th. It's free for iOS and Android. Obviously, you're going to need like a higher end phone. So, if you're on like an Android fucking from 6 years ago, get into the real time. iOS 4, I don't think even exists anymore. So, yeah. I'm just trying to think here what I want to do next. I'm talking to myself. Sorry. We'll finish off with that one. I don't know what this one is, but that's really, really cool. I'm going to read this one because it's really, really interesting. So talking about games that are coming out, one of the things with games coming out is always the issue of pirating. Pirating has been a thing for centuries now. If it's not video games, it's music. If it's not music, it's TV. If it's not TV, it's movies. It's not any of that. It's people joking about stealing cars. I don't know. So pirating is a thing. And there's been discussions, as you know, programmers and technology gets advanced, it's getting harder to steal games. And there's been conversations among, you know, the gaming community as well as these technology-based companies stating that, you know, our algorithms are becoming so strong that they challenge people to essentially crack them. You shouldn't pirate. If you're using something and you really want to, don't pirate something if like you really want to support your community. Like obviously, Bethesda can eat my dick only because they release half fucking ass games that are completed with bugs and glitches and people fucking suck them off for it. So Bethesda bite me. So I will never buy any of your shit.
Wait,
until
are you saying Fallout 4 is broken?
Fallout 4 has been broken since the fucking day it came out. I don't care how many patches. It's still we're still getting highlight clips of broken Fallout 4.
Yep, that is true.
But so. I know some people who have a pirated version of Fallout 4 for this exact fucking reason. Because it's like, I'm not a hardcore enthusiast. I'm like, Steve, for example, has followed the Fallout universe. He knows it. He loves it. Blah, blah, blah. To each your own. If he wants to spend $80 on a fucking game that's broken, it's not just for the game. He likes the game.
Even he was saying, actually, with Fallout 4 that he was actually very disappointed with it. Just overall. Not just with the bugs or anything, but just overall, the whole game was just very lackluster to him.
It was like if you had a piece of tarnished metal and you just polished it, it still got dents in it eventually.
Polishing a turd. That's what it's called.
Yeah, it's like if I put glitter on my shit, it's still a pile of shit. It's just prettier looking. That's it. Wow, that's a really good analogy for Fallout 4. It's just shit with glitter on it. But, so, the issue is, well, it's not an issue. The thing is, these companies are stating, like, hey, you're not going to be able to steal our games, like, and, you know, if it's a company that you love and support. Steve, for example, loves Fallout 4. He's going to buy it. He loves Fallout. He's going to buy it to each their own. I don't encourage pirating. Shut up, Steve. But I, for example, may somehow acquire an illegal version of Fallout 4, however that may be, and just because I'm not willing to put up the money to pay for this game where I don't feel it's worth the money. Companies are now getting stronger, and we're curious now, what is this impact going to be on these companies? Because sometimes pirating is looking as a bad thing. It's also a good PR stunt as well.
Yeah, because, I mean, a lot of stuff has actually been spread because of pirating, because people will go out and swipe this game, or companies themselves have been known to leak copies of games.
Absolutely.
Just to get it in the hands of people, and just to get them to play and be like, I really like this, and then they go and either support the company, if not on that game, on their next game.
Do you know what the most famous one that recently happened that flopped was?
What's that?
Duke Nukem Forever. The entire game was released in its entirety.
Yeah.
The day before it was supposed to come out, and you could play it as is, or was like no authentication or anything. People played it and went, this is fucking garbage.
Yep.
And it flopped on its opening day.
Not surprised.
Hey, you know what? That game, if you're like, The only time you should ever play Duke Nukem Forever is if you're really, really hammered one night and you just want a good laugh. Like,
and that's the thing.
Had a really
trash,
sad
right?
night.
Again, like, being a bit older, like, Duke Nukem was the shit back in the day. So we played that a ton of times. And now it's like, I never actually did end up playing Duke Nukem Forever because of all the, like, shitty ratings and stuff. But I do want to just, like, get a six of beer and play through it in one night, because apparently if you are a Duke Nukem fan, if you play Duke Nukem back in the day, it is still a fun game.
It's a fun game. Like, I am a Duke, like, that's what I grew up with.
Yeah.
I've got them all, 1, 2, 3, 3D, blah, blah, blah. I played it through just to experience it. They fucked them up. It is what it is. It's in my back pocket. Yeah, I don't know. But, like, the impact... So, there's a negative and a positive impact of, like, preventing pirating here.
I think one of the main things why it's probably a positive thing is that for actual developers who make good games that aren't broken, I mean, you want to find a way to support them somehow, right? I mean, they make these games. They put so much time and effort into them, and they deserve recognition, and they should get paid for what they do.
Yep.
Here is my counter-argument to this, and
please.
I love these fucking
yeah, for sure.
guys. So programmers who are aware of pirating, and sometimes the best solution is not to stop it, but to fuck with
oh,
the people
yes.
who are fucking with you.
Yeah.
That too.
And Game Dev Tycoon is the most famous for
that
doing
is,
this.
The prime example.
These guys were the leaders in it, and if you have a pirated game, your company instantly goes bankrupt.
Yep.
And, like, you can't, like, your game doesn't they put code into the game to recognize the authentication system had been bypassed. So they're coding around it. And obviously, there's going to be ways to bypass that eventually, but you just have to... It's an ever-evolving, like, experience and, you know, system, just as the industry is. And they went, fuck it. You know what? If you want to steal our game, fucking steal it.
Yep.
We're going to fuck with you. I can't remember which game it was, but they locked you in an elevator.
Oh, shit. I can't remember what that one was.
That's hilarious.
That was a really good way of doing it, though, because it, or they, you know, that's seemed to be the common thing that was like stopping you in a loading screen or stopping you at a certain point in the game. Like, it would, some guy you'd have to talk to just wouldn't talk to you and stuff.
This one actually wiped out all previous save files. Like, they went into the system and deleted it, so you couldn't even revert.
Wow.
And, like, it would quick save as you're walking in. And then it would just close the doors, so it, like, close the doors, quick save would happen,
yeah.
And then the elevator would start moving, and that would be it.
That's
and
genius.
Then it would wipe, so it was,
yeah.
like, you were just stuck in the elevator, so if you want, it was, like, 6 hours into the game, so
oh,
you'd spend
man.
An initial time in there just fucking with people.
Yeah.
It's the most evil, most beautiful thing I've ever heard.
So I think if they stop pirating, it's just going to fuck them up, because I think, and Steam introduced, you know, the return kind
yep.
of policy, which is good, because sometimes you need a couple hours to...
It was long overdue, because I've bought some games that literally just didn't work on my computer because I had, you know, I had a Radeon video card and it didn't play nice with it. I turn on the game, it crashes in the first level
exactly.
10 times in a row, and they're like, sorry.
So
like, well, where's my $5 back then? Like,
yeah, and sometimes you can, I mean, even with like regular just hard disks and stuff, right? You could buy them and like you buy from a regular retailer or whatever. And suddenly your GameStop was working, and you go back, and it's like, oh, I'm sorry, we don't take a return. You can trade it in, though, and you're
yeah.
like, fuck.
Yeah, so I don't think the proper response is to stop it. I think education is like, this is like the most boring thing I've ever fucking said. The proper response is to educate. Like, understand, like, maybe it's hard to teach ethics and morals. Like, obviously, it's not, like, the most moral or ethic thing to do to go steal someone's, like, hard work.
Yep.
There's teams of these people who are pumped. It's like, even if it, if they're, like, there's a face of a company. There's a company. But there's someone like yourself or myself or someone at home who dive their heart and soul into these things. You know, as artists yourselves, all three of you actually as artists yourselves,
yep.
you put your heart and soul into your creation. So, like, you want it to go out there, but I think there should be a better system from the company itself. Steam has already started to open up those channels for these companies. I'm hoping EA will follow suit with Origin eventually. You know, Ubisoft could follow suit, these kinds of games. So I think if they said, hey, buy the game, play it for a little bit if you don't like it or if there's a problem or whatever, we'll
yep.
just give you your full money back under these very open criteria, like,
yep.
you know, a couple hours is enough time.
Exactly.
And that's it. It'll stop your pirating. And if you are going to pirate it, we're just going to embed code into it that'll just fuck with your experience anyway. And it's not like you can get mad at us because we gave you the game.
Man. Yeah, exactly.
You just did something, man. Not my fucking fault. You're an idiot.
I mean, when you think about it, too, like, what is the reason why people pirate, whether it's games or movies or music? A lot of time, it's, I mean, there's a dollar value to it, sure.
Yep.
But it's also been proven that, like, people are still willing to pay $20 for a CD. I know I've paid up money still for
absolutely
a CD copy or a digital copy of something because you want to support those that particular artist group or whatever.
It's not even about owning the physical medium. It's about just the support and being a part of what they're doing.
Well, exactly. Yep. And you know, giving something back to them. But a lot of it has to do with accessibility of what you're trying to get. There's you know, there's a lot of people say that get shafted on release dates. Australia is a huge
would be
a huge market for pirates because they totally get shafted on release dates. So it's like if you're not making the content accessible to everybody at the same time, then obviously there's going to be people trying to pursue that form of accessibility either by trying to save money
yep
and getting the content for free because they're not willing to put out money for something that they're not really that they're not ready to invest that into, or they're not getting it in a timely manner the way that everybody else is, and they feel like they're being let down by the company that they're trying to support or that they want to support. So there's a huge accessibility issue now. Something like Steam makes that a lot easier. They bring
absolutely
their prices down. They have sales. Everything's ready there for content download. As far as I know, they don't seem, or from what I can tell, they don't seem to have anything that's like region locked. If something has has like a restricted release date.
I think but basically, if you
obviously,
can see
I don't live in
it,
Australia or the UK.
That's what
so
I've seen anyways.
They handle that on their server side.
I live in North America, where everything kind of comes out on a pretty reliable release date, and it's usually ahead of a lot of other people. So, I mean, obviously, I don't live in the UK, I don't live in Australia, so I'm not seeing the limitations on their content releases, but I mean, that's, like I said, like, that's the reason why a lot of people pirate, is they're having an accessibility issue, and so a lot of that has to go back to the developers and back to the publishers to make things more readily accessible to help prevent the pirating.
Something really interesting to note about, so you just brought up the point of, like, content or region locking things. Fucking commercials, man. They go so fucking loud. This is why I don't like TV. Is the reason that they region law, like you may, there's actually different laws of what you can show in things. Movies, television, gaming. Yep. Australia has some really, really funny ones.
I wouldn't call them funny exactly. I'd call them archaic.
Yeah, they've got some interesting ones. So that's why they region lock. So, like, obviously, companies can actually be fined hundreds of thousands of dollars if their stuff makes it into the country. So as a, like, let's say an Australian player, if I somehow get a copy into it and it is found inside, because the legal rights still belong to that company, they don't take mitigating, like, they don't mitigate that risk, they'll just be like, no, fuck you, like, that's $500,000, like, you got your shit and you were supposed to follow our rules, you didn't follow our rules, and now you're no longer allowed to bring your products into it, and, like, all you need is one person or two people to fucking mess that shit up. So I think, like you said, if you have these return policies, you have these different things based on your region locks or whatever it is, if you earn that trust with your, like, I'm an Australian player, yes, I have to wait an extra day for it, I don't know if it's going to be good, but I'm going to get it, unless you're like Fallout 4 where people were risking their entire fucking Steam accounts to get it 24 hours in advance.
Yeah.
Like, if I'm going to wait like an extra couple hours and know that it's not going to be good and then I can return it, fine, whatever. It's not a big deal. So, I think we all agree on that whole ban point. So,
yeah. It's the region lock and a big part of it's price too. I mean, this just goes with what AAA devs are doing now, is that the common price for a new game now is like $70 to $80, and that just keeps climbing and climbing because video games are Hollywood now, so they have to keep feeding that monster.
It also comes with
money,
the technology to make it though,
and there is that too, but I don't know, it's, I kind of have a problem with how some of the bigger stuff runs like that. That's why I've sticked with some of the smaller games, and Steam has been an absolute godsend too, because I can go on there and I can find games that are not only interesting and stuff, but they're not just like, oh, great, that's, like, the one game I can buy, you know, this month or this couple months or something like that, because it costs $80 after tax, because being Canadian, we have to pay extra for shit, too. So
I keep
it's
ripping
like
on Fallout 4, but I had to laugh at their 17% price drop at the fucking Christmas
fall. Yeah, I know. It's like
So I'm just going to deviate from our notes here just because it's relevant to the conversation. Is one of the bigger things that we missed during our break was what was called the Steam Christmas Fail.
yes.
As dubbed from the Steam Christmas Sale. So this was... It blew up, and I was a little bit annoyed that it blew up to... Like, I get it. There's reasons that it blew up because it came from such a large company. So for those of you who don't know what happened is... On Christmas Day, I believe. It was Christmas Day.
Yeah.
Steam experienced a massive denial of service or DDoS attack from China. Origin of China. It could have come from anywhere. In terms of the technology world, ways to mitigate having your service go down during like such a massive time is to what's called cache things. And what caching is it takes a snapshot of something in time and just stores it for a certain amount of time so that it reduces, you know, server load so that if I want to go see that information, it says, has it been longer than this or has it changed at all? No. Okay, we'll go give them the cache version. Fuck it. Don't touch it. For some reason, the caching server had a fucking error on it. Allowed 30,000 different accounts to accidentally be seen. And they say private information. So there was telephone numbers. There was the last four digits of people's credit cards. There was email addresses. I think some people's accounts had first and last names, depending on what you had in terms of personal information.
Yeah. I think there was also cases where people could see the admin panel, too. Like,
well, it depends on what you were trying to access. Like, it was just randomly fed. So it depends on what the caching server actually gave to you. So that's why it was so randomized and only 30,000 people hit, because it just happened to be a very small slice that was being, like, that was... accidentally screwed up, because these servers are massive. There's servers all over the place, because think of the amount of people who are hitting Steam on a regular basis, right?
It's worldwide, so...
Absolutely. So, absolutely, it is the biggest... Like, personal information, by all means, is the most important information on the internet. It is... You can get anything with personal information, and 90% of all hacking is not actually people sitting at a keyboard typing in... It's called what we call social engineering. It is... And the most famous one is actually the Apple, PayPal, Amazon social engineering hack, which would allow you to access someone's Apple account by adding a fake credit card to their Amazon account and then accessing their account on Amazon via that fake credit card and blah, blah, blah. So the internet blew up and went, what the fuck? Like, what is going on here? Valve said nothing.
I think we actually even made some posts on our site too about it, just as the news came out and we updated it and everything.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure there was something.
Yeah, we did release some kind of information on it, but here's where my, and this is just because I'm an informed IT professional, I know what I'm talking about. This is where I understand as the general, the Joes out there and the Janes and everything who are worried. I have my credit card on my Steam account, which is probably the worst decision I've ever made because I buy things I never need. But I was like, you know what? I'm going to let it sit. The last four digits of my credit card, good fucking luck doing something with them.
Yeah, like, exactly.
Email address can, like, okay, fuck. I'm going to have to maybe turn on my spam if a little bit harder if I'm getting hit, that kind of stuff. I understand that people got upset because they didn't know what was going on and they were waiting for a response from Valve. But people should also understand that nothing on the internet is safe. I'm talking, even if it's behind a security wall, it is not safe.
Yep.
At any point. And we look at Ashley Madison hacks. We look at LinkedIn got hacked a while ago. We look, I know...
Well, you can go all the way up to the Pentagon. I mean, people hack into that shit all the time.
Nuclear reactors are being taken over as we speak somewhere overseas. Like, if it is connected onto the internet at any point, it is... And if you do not trust it, get it off of the internet.
Yeah.
Because, like, so I had to laugh when people kind of were, like, up in arms. I'm like, this was coming eventually. Like,
it is what it is. It's just one in a long line of things that could be hacked and probably will be hacked.
I mean, and it's not like it's, you know, the first... It'll happen periodically. Not saying that, like, oh, it's a, well, whatever thing. I mean, it is kind of a big deal. But, like, you know, we've seen it happen for Steam with PS4, like, the PSN and everything like that. Like... It's just like you said, anything you put on there, you're risking it, so.
Yeah, it's like, so Valve has released their statement. There was roughly around 30,000 people affected. They are working with the team because they actually outsourced their servers to another company to go through those records to find out who those 30,000 people are. If you are contacted, they are going to help you mitigate getting in any trouble, blah, blah, blah. If something was going to happen, we would have seen it by now. Nothing's happened. Obviously, people, there's a famous quote from a YouTuber. this is, people were just angry at that thing at that time.
Yep.
And then next day there was probably something else to be angry at.
Absolutely.
Like,
of course, that's how the internet works.
Yeah, like, it's just like, fuck
it,
whatever.
How life works, basically.
Also, I like to call it the fail because the Steam sales, like usual, are garbage fucking now. But we're running a little bit low on time here, so I'm just going to move on for us, and I'm actually going to skip these last 2 points.
Should we go on break so that we can get Josh on here?
I don't think we have any commercials set up.
He could just step over the table.
He could.
No.
No.
No, I think we're just going to... Sorry, Josh, I love you, but...
Oh, but he put notes in and everything.
That's okay. He was going to take my game anyway, so...
Oh, well then.
Josh!
Get in here. This is unprofessional. He just walked away from me. He's not coming to the catch, so we're moving on. Okay, so you know what? We're going to start out with Steve. Hi, Steve.
Steve,
our last point actually is he's going to get the fucking microphone that we should have done originally. Thank you. So we're going to start off while we're waiting for Josh to get his lovely booty back. Is the list of our games for 2015. I'm going to let you guys start with this because I'm going to have to do some... we got headphones.
Some audio magic there?
We don't have other headphone port. You fucked. Just deal with it.
Okay, so I guess we're going to get cozy.
Yeah. You're just going to get cozy. You can scoot up next to Dan there or something. I don't know. Come on, just... I swear to God, I showered this morning.
There we go. Yeah. Okay.
Hi, Josh.
We're gonna sit next to each other because we both love the same game. So,
so I guess I'll start with you two homos. No homo. I'm just kidding.
No homo.
By the way, there's nothing wrong with that. So it's just, you know, that kind of nomenclature. But we'll start with you two guys. So we've gone through the rest of the news, Josh. I don't know if you've been listening to us the entire night. But we're actually gonna start with So we're actually going to start with you guys for your Game of the Year for 2015. I know it's already first week of January. We should have done this last time. but in typical Scrubs fashion, we're going to do it at the beginning of 2016.
Everyone had their list of 2015 Game of the Year. Like,
we also got to play a lot more over holidays,
It was like, here's our list of Game of the Year. And I was like, well, screw it.
I didn't play any games over holidays.
Let's just do our own.
So
that's okay.
We're
going
to slap the mic over to you. You're going to tell me what your Game of 2015 is.
Okay. I'm going to go a little bit off the beaten path.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
And sorry. I'm going to go a little bit off the beaten path and recommend something that I've actually only actually played about 40 minutes
of. Did you do coke before you got on this couch?
Sorry,
slow the fuck down. Did you do a bunch of cocaine? Slow down.
You don't
have to answer that. Okay, one more time.
All right. So.
There we go.
My game of 2015
Ketamine.
Is Rocket League. I've only actually played about 40 minutes of it myself.
I swear to God he did a bunch of ecstasy.
Not only did I watch the entire cast that Pyro here did at Baseland 29.
Rocket League cast, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. I caught other Rocket League stuff as well. And I'm nominating it not necessarily because it's like the game that's got the best graphics or the prettiest or the best experience of 2015, but for the impact that it made, not on our wallets, but on our consciousness. It was the game that I heard the most people talking about. It was the game that I heard people take people by surprise, right? As you mentioned earlier in the podcast, it was only MLG and Baseland that have done Rocket League tournaments.
So far.
So far. Like, if you want to talk wallets, a game from that had, like, no marketing, word of mouth, nothing, became the number 4 game of 2015, I know, right, on Steam.
Mm-hmm.
It sold about $30 million, and the number 6 all-time, number 4 game from 2015 on Steam. And it's just... Everyone was talking about it. It made the biggest impact. It's an instant esport, and how often does that happen? So many times, games will try so hard to become esports. They're not built for it. Rocket League is. That's why it's my nomination.
Not to mention, it's just something you can pick up and play easily.
Right?
It's both casual and competitive, so...
Yeah, and it bridges that gap, which is so hard to do.
Well said. Dendroid, do you want to put your 2 cents on this? Because I know...
He stole all my thunder, so... Yeah. No,
he does have a massive erection as well.
That's okay. We'll deal with that later.
Yeah. He got
No. Literally, it was... before I even saw the list of what everyone's picks were, because she was putting the list together, I was just like, Rocket League. She's just like, oh, Jesse took that one. Or it was like, Rocket League. Sorry, it's mine. Because unlike your 40 minutes... I put in about 40 hours over my Christmas holidays, which is still like amateur league compared to a lot of the other guys out there. Because I've been watching a bunch of the like MLG matches on YouTube and everything. I just, it's voodoo magic. It's amazing what some of those guys can do, and I can only dream of being that good some days. So, but no, it was literally one of those games that, even though I still don't have a PS4, I got the free download for it. It's sitting on my account for when I get a PS4. Not only did I get the game for free, I went and I had to play it. So I bought it on Steam when it was on discount. They had
it was like 75% off.
They had the game, but yeah, they had all the DLC packed with it too. And I was just like, fuck it. This is one of the best games I've ever played. It's one of the most fun. And I will give them more and more money. Like, I want them to succeed because they made such an amazing product.
Is it out for Xbox One yet?
No, it's February.
February, okay. It's so coming soon.
Yeah, it will come soon.
Awesome.
to
and all
those
of them
Xbox
are cross-compatible.
And yeah, so... But no, it really is. Like, it is my game of 2015 just because... for a game that I couldn't play most of the year unless I was here at Reset or at a buddy's house or something like that, I couldn't play it at my own house, and I still wanted to play it. I still thought about it. I played it any chance I could. Now that I have it, I play it like nonstop, and I will continue to play it. So
all right, so we're losing Dandroid.
I just wanted to bring up the cross play compatibility of it. Only PlayStation and Steam will crossplay with each other. Xbox and Microsoft has a licensing type of thing where they will not do crossplay.
They don't play
nice with anybody.
Steam and PlayStation and Sony actually got in on this a long time ago together, where like you can actually log into Steam on PlayStation too. So that's probably why they talk to each other. It's already set up to do it.
Yeah, exactly. So Microsoft will not play nice with anybody. It's part of their licensing agreements with video games and developers and stuff. Yeah.
Of course, Microsoft. Being actually old school Microsoft, that's weird for them. All right, well, now that we're already on to you,
this
lovely Jay Tanuki.
Well, okay, I didn't actually play any games that came out this year.
Why do we have you on here?
I know,
I'm
right?
Just kidding.
But I kind of thought outside the box and went sort of like in an offline, non-digital mode, and I played a whole bunch of board games this year.
All right.
Some of them are like older games than that, but there were two of them that came out this year that like... I'm like, hook me up, because I'm so into it now. There's Dead of Winter, which is really awesome. Both the games that I
definitely have tried. Great game.
Yeah. Both of them are definitely in like my game of the year. I really couldn't pick one, but Dead of Winter is like a really awesome co-op game. It's a zombie survival, and it definitely has like the actions that the players take have a lot of repercussions and have their consequences, and they hold a lot of weight to them. So it's definitely one of like the best zombie survival or survival
and
based
the, and the paranoia factor
games. Yeah, and it has a paranoia effect, absolutely. Yeah. And then my tied up game with that is Pandemic Legacy.
It's another great game, actually.
Yeah. I played the Risk Legacy when that came out, and like I love the idea of that. Obviously, like there's you're playing with like sort of almost like a campaign mode with your friends that you like always play board games with, mm-hmm. and so it has something like Pandemic where it has a co-op portion of it, but it still has those repercussions of you are going to tear up this card and it will never exist again.
Yeah,
you are going to put these stickers on your board and it will be there forever for mm-hmm. the rest of your game. Characters will die and they will never come back. You'll never be able to play them again. You will tear them up, they will be gone.
Yeah.
And same thing with all the bonuses that you had put on them with stickers.
Yeah.
And so to be able to play like that kind of a campaign with my close friends and have that like the typical Pandemic gameplay is absolutely phenomenal.
Tons of fun, actually. So yeah, even though not video games, great, great, great titles overall.
For my game of the year, this one has been brought up many times on the podcast.
I'm pretty sure we suck their dick once a week. Like, I'm not even fucking kidding you. Can they just be a sponsor already so that we can start monetizing off of how much fucking talk we get to them? Go ahead. Sorry, I took your line, Mike.
It's all good. My game of the year would have to be The Witcher 3. And I had bought it a little while back when we got our PS4, but I finally, over the holidays, sat down and played a massive amount of it, and I really love it. And... I think the reason why it's a bit special to me is
Geralt is such a hunk.
He is a hunk. Oh. He is a hunk. I think one of the reasons why it's special to me, though, is it just kind of felt like it was one of those really good games where you can have so many random quests and just you don't even have to play the storyline all that much. It's just the quests most of the time are just like so much more fun.
They're
and pretty good. And it doesn't even feel like you're. I mean, for some of the contracts and some of the quests that you do, they require certain levels, and so you just kind of like you can kind of run around and happen upon enemies and stuff. But the nice thing about that is it doesn't really feel like it's grinding really. And when I come across locations where there are enemies and stuff, it's almost with a purpose, whether you have to destroy monster nests or whether you have to like find a hidden treasure or something like that. And when you complete those, quests and those like locations and stuff, it just feels really satisfying.
Well, it's a sign of a good game. If you can get lost in it, it doesn't feel like a chore or a job.
I mean, I'm pretty sure I spent like 20 hours just doing quests. I wasn't even on the main story. I just did quests hours.
I have a friend who actually had to restart her file because all she did was like side quests. And she was just so powerful by the end of it, she couldn't even play the main storyline and enjoy it because there was no challenge anymore. She walked through all the side quests, and then she was like level 28 and like the last story. It's like, I just killed the thing in one shot. I've got everything. It's like, this is not fun anymore. So she had to restart it and like sort of do some side quests and sort of do some main storyline and sort of do some story quests. So yeah.
Yeah, no, it's, I really like it. And I mean, even when you're doing just like boring tasks like gathering your potion supplies, it's like you get so excited to find a shrub and you're like, oh man, I got this, I don't have this yet. And also it kind of becomes almost essential to kind of do those contracts and all those quests at one point, because money is a thing in the game. It's not readily available like how you do with most games where you get money.
It's just like
you
it's your main
exactly
like, reward.
So doing it even gathering supplies or like doing just finding small, like finding bandits or like killing monsters and stuff just to sell your stuff or to just get money out of, you know, doing your contracts or your quests and stuff. It's a huge thing just to do that. So it's really, really fulfilling and satisfying. It was one of the best games I played in a really long time.
Not to mention they did actually win Game of the Year at this year's VGA. So
I think it was multiple places too. There's a lot of places.
Yeah.
They got Game
four
of
awards.
Yeah.
I think they got like, no, they didn't get music. That was Ori and the Blind Forest.
I know they got.
Oh, no, beyond the Game Awards or whatever, the other companies.
Yeah, they've gotten other awards.
Yeah, even for like the Canadian Game Awards, they got like international Game
Yeah, those guys, Project Red's doing some great things. So if you guys haven't played The Witcher 3, just pick that shit up.
Just
like
play
it's like on sale like half the time. Those guys are giving it away for free half the time.
And they also had a sale going on too where you could get The Witcher 1 and 2 for like a ridiculously cheap amount.
It was like $5 or something
for
the first two, and then they dropped like the full game down, like Witcher 3 down to like $35. So you could get like all three games, and then you just had to pay for a couple DLCs. But even like the main game for Witcher 3 is like 60 hours of main gameplay.
Witcher 3, you get three free DLCs, and then they have one pay one.
They've got two pay right now. They've only got one paid, one coming up. Sorry.
And even so, with those DLCs, it's not like it's just content that they didn't have time to put in. It's like separate storylines, separate quests, and everything too. Like it's.
I think the next one's coming out at the end of the first quarter of this year.
I think so.
Blood and Wine.
Blood and Wine.
Yeah, Blood and Wine. Yeah.
Yeah, because they want to actually release like another full game as a DLC. But good pick. I like that.
Yeah.
Fucking solid pick. Jesus. I guess I'm last to go because Steve is currently off saving the world. Fuck. I thought about this. You guys asked me like a long time ago, and I'm like, I don't know. So I didn't
send you a list. This is what's been released.
So TLDR. Fuck that list.
Yeah. It's kind of bad.
It was fucking super bad. Honestly, I was really, really thinking about it, and I know Jesse was like, that's a really good one. Mine has to be, believe it or not, Counter-Strike Global Offensive, and it's not because I just like the game and I shoutcast it. I want to say in terms of growth, the game has been out for ages, and this was the biggest year in terms of growth and viewership and community outreach that the game, it actually surpassed Dota 2 as the largest viewed or online, concurrent players online for Steam ever.
Wow.
Dota 2 currently held the record at over 1 million at one time. Mm-hmm. Counter-Strike is now the record holder. So it's going to show that a game that has been out and is working and, you know, still plays back to 1.5 back in the day, still has an insanely solid following. Not to mention when the R8 and that whole fucking debacle happened, Valve listened to them and went, sorry. So, like, the developers and the company are looking at the community. They're looking, okay, we want your opinion. We did something wrong. They'll roll back and they'll apologize, but they're ever growing. They have it's not just closed door. Like, anyone can go into their map workshop, submit maps. There's all these different things happening. So, you know, skins, it's got its own economy system at this fucking point.
Yeah.
It's stupid. But in terms of growth and overall, just like, holy shit, its presence has just been ever known. Witcher 3 did great, but like Counter-Strike Global Offensive is just kind of that guy behind the closed door that like everybody knows who he is. Everyone has a story with him, whether it's watching it at a venue, having the game, having been kicked out of the game multiple times. I'm not going to name names, and having to buy her the game. And they constantly put the game on sale. Most of the time people are like, if you want to get into Counter-Strike, don't buy the game at like $20. Wait for like a week and it'll go on sale for like $6.
Yeah, as we saw for like every 3 weeks.
Yeah, it's like on sale every 3 weeks and it's like $8 to buy the game. And not to mention, it's got such a different curve from casual gameplay to like severely, severely competitive, as we saw on the weekend.
Yeah.
Anybody can pick it up. It, you know, fair. Anybody can play anything. It's not based on roles, that kind of stuff. It's anybody can do anything. You define what you are. Your skill is your skill. So, yeah, I just like, I couldn't think of anything else in terms of like what actually, besides The Witcher 3, but that's fucking, like, goddamn, those guys are just doing magical things.
I have one notable mention I actually just thought of. Keep talking and nobody explodes.
That one was probably
notable mention.
That one was probably fun just because it was such a team building exercise. Yeah. Like that one, like,
and it was
broke
that
relationships.
Gameplay and I mean, they did a good job with coming up with something unique that sort of incorporated video games.
And it didn't cost $80.
With
exactly.
Something that was like tangible, yeah, that you could hold. It was kind of a, it was a really unique experience. So I think they get definitely get a notable mention.
Absolutely. So yeah, great, great notable mention to end off of. But that's it for us tonight, you guys. Thank you to Reset Interactive Ultra Lounge for providing us the location, as well as MSI for the great, great technology being able to bring you some of this podcast. We couldn't do it without them. Make sure you guys head over to Reset Interactive Ultra Lounge on Facebook.com.
Great food.
Yeah, absolutely. Head over to MSI. Like their pages. These guys are always doing awesome things on their pages. As well, make sure to follow us here on Twitch.tv. Hit that follow button in the bottom left corner. To get notifications when we do go live. We do actually are starting. This week we started it. We do weekly stuff now.
It's happening.
It started.
It's happening.
So yeah. Everyone's doing stuff. You guys did like a, you did a cosplay thing actually on Monday to fill in for my spot,
yeah,
which was really,
yeah,
nice. Thank
you
for that.
I did a cosplay thing on Monday where Dandroid ended up wrapping me up in duct tape so that I can make a torso cast so I can get started on a new armor set. Super,
yeah,
exciting.
We've got creative stuff coming from you as well.
Yeah, I'm going to be possibly doing some digital art and some painting and stuff at one point.
That's
really,
awesome.
Really soon.
Dandroid, you've got
and
a penis house.
The
Tuesday night void with the level one Sims.
Which I was telling the bartenders here and they didn't know about it. They're going to start watching because they think
nice.
That's hysterical.
Okay. I need to talk to you after the show to help me fix my computer because it was not cooperating on Tuesday.
All right,
so
we'll talk about
we
that.
We definitely have to get it running for next week.
Okay, and I don't know what Steve's doing. Steve's probably, I think, Steve, are you still doing a cooking show? I don't know. Steve's doing a cooking show, I think.
Steve and his beard want to do a cooking,
yeah,
show.
Yeah, Steve will do something. If you know MSN, Modern Size Steve, he is going to be in there with something insanity, and I am going to be bringing you content every Monday, probably in the form of World of Warcraft or something stupid, as I usually do. So make sure to follow us there on Twitch, as well as go to our Facebook page. Again, thank you to everybody on the couch. It's been lovely to see your faces again after so long. Until next time, guys, thank you for tuning in. Aaron Kerry, brr!